alive. My name is Caleb Liro, and this is the day the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. I want to share a word of prayer with you. Father, I thank you for everyone connected to this live stream right now. Thank you for your glory and goodness that is made available in our hearts today. Lord, thank you for your word that will come to us and will make a difference in our lives. Thank you for what you're doing this season for us and how you're making us to becoming conscious of your righteousness, how you're bringing us to having full understanding of who you are and what you do in our lives this season. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, on Wednesday, we started a new series, Righteousness Consciousness. And we talked about righteousness consciousness versus sin consciousness. We said sin consciousness is focusing on the power of sin over you and your inability to live right. And then righteousness consciousness is a complete trust on the finished work of Jesus. That means you trust the finished work of Jesus that your mistakes cannot stain your righteousness. No matter the mistakes you make, it cannot stain your righteousness. Was that sin consciousness is a bondage which we have been set free from. We've been set free from the bondage of sin. We'll be set free from that bondage that will always be a reminder to us of how imperfect we are. Now we are forever righteous through the blood of Jesus. Praise God. And we gave a typical example of thinking of it as a parent would not disown a child because of mistakes. So God would not disown you when you make mistakes. We brought that scenario so you have that full understanding of God's relationship with you and the fact that he won't let you go. He won't disown you because you made a mistake or whatsoever. Praise God. Hallelujah. And today we said we're going to take a step further on righteousness consciousness, and we're going to talk about the devil's tricks. The devil's tricks. And we need to understand the role the devil plays in this day and age, the position which he takes. Hallelujah. Now we'll try to establish the fact on Wednesday that we are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. We've been establishing this part since for the past 2 to 3 months now. Or 2, 3, 4 months, we've been establishing a certain fact that you are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. Praise the Lord. We try to discover your position in Christ, discover your personality in Christ. And one of them is the fact that you are the righteousness of God. And then some time ago, we discussed the fact that God has made you righteous. Your righteousness is not based on what you can do or what you have done. No, it is based on what Christ has done on the cross. And your ability to accept the work Christ has done makes you righteous. So righteousness is a gift you get. It's a gift that comes from your belief, your trust in Jesus. From the fact that you believe in Jesus and you confess with your mouth as Lord, it gives you the gift of righteousness. Praise God. So it is a gift you've gotten that cannot be taken away from you. Hallelujah. As long as you keep believing on the work of the Holy Spirit, the finished work of Christ on the cross, the work which the Holy Spirit has done through Christ, as long as you keep believing and confessing him with your mouth daily, you remain the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. No one can take it away from you. We talked about the fact that we are humans, we can make mistakes. Oh, yes, we can. But you see, our mistakes cannot even separate us from the love of Christ. The Bible says, what can separate us from the love of Christ? What is it? Nothing at all can. Not tribulation, not sin, not famine, not troubles. Nothing can separate us from the love of Christ. Amen. And his love is so genuine that as long as we keep drawing to him, he remains with us. God is most faithful. Praise God. Except you want to tell me that the work Christ has done on the cross is not good enough, but the work he had done is perfect. It is perfect. The work he had done on the cross is perfect and good enough. And because his work is perfect, we are recipients of the finished work. We are recipients of his glory, which have been exhibited from the finished work on the cross. We are recipients of this glory. We are recipients of what Christ has done. Praise God. So we are living witnesses. Amen. We are living witnesses, living as the righteousness of God here on earth. Amen. Praise the Lord. And as the righteousness of God, one thing God wants you to do, which is very key in your walk with him, is to always be conscious of righteousness. The moment you lose that consciousness and begin to tilt towards thinking about sin, thinking about your wrongs or how you do wrong, then you begin to lose your righteousness. Praise God. This is how you walk out the righteousness, the salvation of fear and trembling. This is how you keep righteousness by keeping the mindset. I said sometimes that being precedes doing. You become, then you do. No, in the world, you do, then you become. Praise God. But see, in the things of God, you become first before you do. And then you become righteous by your belief. Then you now begin to act out the righteousness on your daily activities, on your daily work. But you become first. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. And we've talked about how to become righteous severally. We've gone around it over and over and over. You're believing God, you're trusting God, declaring Him as Lord and Savior for your life, then you become the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. But now we are focusing on the mindset you need to have to keep the fire burning, to keep that righteousness instincts up and running. Praise God. The boldness you need, that consistency you need so you can keep it going. Hallelujah. It's not a one-off. You keep it going consistently in your life and destiny. Praise the Lord. And then today we're going to look at the devil's tricks. Now, the devil's job, his job is to kill, steal, and destroy. Amen. His job is to kill, to steal, and to destroy. And the only way he can access you to do that is if he can steal your righteousness. If he can steal your righteousness, and he knows he can't take it because your righteousness cannot be stained by your wrongs. He may get you to do wrong. He may get you to sin against God, but he knows that is not enough. Praise God. He has got you to sin against God. That's one step. He now needs to cause you to stop believing in the finished work of Christ. Praise the Lord. He wants you to begin to doubt what Christ has done, to doubt if forgiveness is still available for you, to doubt if you have the ability to receive forgiveness each time you go wrong, to doubt if Christ would even consider letting you receive forgiveness, to doubt that your righteousness is a gift from God and does not require any other action. He wants you to begin to doubt this part. And the moment you begin to doubt this, then you lose your righteousness. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Because God is not going to take it away from you. You lose it by not believing. He said that you're condemned already because you've not believed on the only begotten Son of the Father. So the moment you stop believing, then condemnation comes. Praise the Lord. So the devil wants you to stop believing so he can introduce condemnation. So he plays all kind of theatrics, all kind of things, just to get you to that position, to that point where you begin to condemn yourself, where you begin to lose your trust, your utmost trust in God, which is your strongest weapon, which is your strongest strength, which is the route to sustaining the righteousness that God has given to you. Praise the name of Jesus. Praise the name of Jesus. So let's look up four different ways the devil acts and he works and he tries to get us off course. Number one is accuser of the brethren. No, remember the book of Job where the devil came before God? I'm going to talk about Job. Well, the Bible says that's his full-time job, you know, to accuse the brethren. And I'm going to surprise you here because the book of Job is an exceptional case. The devil doesn't go to accuse you before God because he knows if he goes to God to accuse you before God, and God turns to look at you, God won't see you right now. In the time of Job, God will see Job and his sin because Jesus had not died and his blood had not been shed. Job was not the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. Job was just a man trying to survive based on the law. So his deeds was important. He had to keep the law. He had to make sacrifice. So the devil can come to God and tell him, oh, you see, this guy is wrong. The devil can come and accuse Moses, accuse Joshua, accuse the chief priest before God and say this one they are wrong people, they are not righteous, their deeds are evil, because these guys are under the law, they are bound to keep certain rules and regulations. But you see, you're no more under the law. So the devil goes to Jesus, to God rather, and tells him, Mr. A, Mr. B is a sinner, he sinned against you yesterday, he sinned against you today, he keeps doing this and this, and then God turns around and says, okay, let me check. Maybe if God brings out his laptop and then types your name, you know, let me just, you know, God is more modern than you think he is. He goes on his 4D screen, you know, beyond 3D, and then he swipes through to get to you. He doesn't see your righteousness because the Bible says your righteousness is like futile work. What he sees is the righteousness of Jesus Christ. So he tells Lucifer, no, this guy is pure. He's pure. Someone else has already paid the price for him. It's a very short, the repentance has been made available and he keeps accepting it. He has accepted repentance. So I can't see anything no more. I can't see the sins no more. I can't see the wrongs no more. I can't see these accusations no more. They aren't there. And he's aligned. He keeps coming boldly and then he accepts grace and mercy for time of need. So I can't see any of these things you said. So what are you talking about? He's pure. He is the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. He's my righteousness in Christ. He is hidden in Christ and Christ in God. Or Christ is in him, the hope of his glory. So there is no sin in him. He's just like me. Wow, how come you accuse an innocent guy? Because you already have an advocate that speaks for you, that has spoken for you, that keeps speaking for you. His blood speaks better things than the blood of Abel. So he sees the blood of Jesus and he says, this guy is clean and is pure. Amen. There is nothing wrong in him. There is no wickedness in him because there is no wickedness in Jesus. Jesus is standing in his place. Jesus took his place 2,000 years ago. So the devil is a smart guy. I'm going to get to that. So he's a smart guy. He knows if he goes to God, this is what's going to happen. And probably he has maybe gone to God one or two times, a few times. It's God, I know this is, I'm wasting my time. So what am I going to do? Let's see Revelation chapter 12, verse 9 and 10. And the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceived the whole world. He was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. And I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now is come salvation and strength, and the kingdom of our God, and the power of his Christ. For the accuser of our brethren is cast down, which accused them before our God day and night. He goes before God day and night, accusing the brethren. And what is his goal of doing this? You know, he comes to deceive the world, and then he comes for God, and day and night he's accusing you, and God looks, no, this one is pure. So he sends his agents to go, they seduce you to do, maybe tell a lie, go fornication, do something wrong, commit adultery, do something wrong against God, and then he comes for God, and then he goes, no, I can see my blood over him, and then he comes back to you, and he tells you, see, God did not hear you. You see, God cannot hear you, you are too sinful, and then he makes you to begin to doubt your salvation. The moment you begin to doubt, he goes back to God, yes, look at him, he's beginning to doubt the finished work you have on the cross, and then God can't do anything anymore, because he looks, and then he beholds you. You have gone out of alignment. You refuse to accept forgiveness. You refuse. You don't worthy. And the moment you don't see yourself worthy, you aren't worthy. The Bible says, if your heart condemns you, God is greater than your heart. If your heart condemns you not, then you are at peace with God. So the moment the devil gets your heart to begin to condemn you, then, God is tired because he can't do anything anymore. He can't do anything no more. Because now you that was supposed to believe and accept this work, you're not going to reject it. And the moment you reject the finished work of Christ, even if you have been saved already, when you begin to reject it, then you begin to lose your salvation, because your salvation is tied to your belief and what you say. Praise God. It is tied to what you believe and what you say. Amen. What you say is tied to what you believe. So your salvation is tied to what you say. And what you say is tied to what you believe. So that means your salvation is tied to what you believe. Amen. Praise the Lord. As a man speaks in his mouth, so he is. That's so he is. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. So the devil is the accuser of the brethren. That is what he does day and night. And then he begins to plot schemes that would give him the leverage to effectively accuse you. And that's why people are tempted. The devil sees that you like something, he uses that thing to tempt you. He sees you like iPhone, he uses iPhone to tempt you. He sees you are in a haste, you don't want to get stranded, he comes to tempt you with bribes and the rest. He sees that you're a good man, he comes to tempt you what you do, whatever, he finds a way and then tries to get your attention. You know, when Jesus was hungry, the devil came to tempt him with food. I mean, it is food. It's not like food is a bad thing. And it's not like what he even told him to do is a bad thing. He also didn't command this stone to become bread. I mean, you are a man of God. You can't just tell the stone to become bread. Was he wrong to tell the stone to become bread? No. Was Jesus really in need of the bread? Yes. Could God have made the stone to become bread if Jesus said it? Maybe. I don't know. But why did he not do it? Because it was a command from the devil. It was the devil tempting him. The devil wasn't tempting him to break his fast. He just was ready to break his fast. Because he had just fasted 40 and 40 nights. He was ready to go. The devil came to tempt him, to make him, to obey him, to do something for pride. Because him commanding the stone to become bread was maybe show off or self or whatever. The devil was trying to get Jesus to do to his bidding. And so he could start from command the stone, and then he went on to jump down, and then angels will guard you. Just go and display your power, let the people see you. Most people do that today. You fall into that pride. Bible says pride goes before a fall. So he tries to make him show yourself off, you know. If you're a son of God, show yourself off. And then he goes up and says, okay, no, I'll bow down before me. You see, if Jesus had obeyed the first, he would have probably obeyed the second, and then he would have obeyed the third. So one thing would have led to the other, and Jesus would have ended up bowing down. Maybe he commanded the stone and didn't turn to bread. Maybe he had jumped down, then he broke his leg. That was okay, I will help you. Praise God. You see, because most times God doesn't respond to you trying to use him to show off. When God brought down fire from heaven for Elijah, it wasn't for show off. No, it was for him to show to the Israelites that he is God. Amen. It was because if it was because Elijah wanted to show off and tell them, no, I'm a man of God, let me prove to you that nothing will happen. Because it is God that does as he wills. You come, he pray, he do as he wills. But he wanted to show that the word of the Sabbath is for him and the glory was going to be given to him. Anything you do that is not to the glory of God is wrong and is a sin. Praise God. Everything you do must be to the glory of God. Once it is for your own personal glory, it is the devil trying to take advantage of you in that instance and is leading you towards the wrong path. The devil is not just the great accuser of the brethren, he is the great deceiver. You know, you mentioned that in Revelation that we read now. And in 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse number 14, we're going to talk a whole Bible talks about it that more. 2 Corinthians 11, verse 14, Bible says, and no marvel, for Satan himself has transformed himself, as Satan, for Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light. So he comes in deceptive ways, he comes as if he's an angel of light. You know, when he began to come to Jesus, it's a cunning step. You know, telling this stone to become bread is not necessarily wrong. But you see, it is one thing that will lead to another. And then you see, just take a bottle. Just take a bottle. You're going to be all right. Okay, just take a second one. And then the next thing you find yourself drunk, he comes bit by bit. No. See, it's not called bribe. What you want to take now is not called bribe, it's lobby. Or it's just a gift. Then you take it and then you do favor for a gift. You do favor, the person buys you, and then your hands are tied, and then you do, and then before you know it, it becomes a habit. The devil comes in corny like an angel of light. It comes as if he's from God. But see, that's wolf in sheep clothing. Praise the Lord. The devil is a con artist. He is a con artist. Like I was supposed to read 11 verse 3. By fear, at least by any means, as the serpent beguiled Eve through his subtlety, so your mind should be corrupted from the simplicity that is in Christ. The devil comes as a con artist. He comes to deceive you just as he deceived Eve. And then he will corrupt your mind through simple things that he take you away from the simplicity of the gospel of Christ. That is how he deceives the people. And then he has transformed himself to an angel of light so he can con people, become the perfect con artist that will take people out of the path of Christ. Praise the Lord. The devil is a perfect artist, con artist. He's the father of it. And then in John chapter number 8, verse 44. John chapter number 8, verse 44. The devil is called the father of lies. The Bible says, ye are of your father the devil, and the lust of your father ye will do. He was a murderer from the beginning and abode not in the truth, because there is no truth in him. When he speaketh a lie, he speaketh of his own, for he's a liar and the father of it. Praise God. So this is Jesus Christ saying here, the devil is the father of lies. So this is how he tries to deceive like the truth. You know, it is not the truth, but it doesn't sound like a lie. It is half truth. So he could tell you half truth. If you eat this fruit, you will not surely die. You know, like you don't eat. Well, they didn't die, but that was half truth. The truth was, you are going to die. Then they won't die, it means their flesh will still be alive. That was half truth. He didn't tell them the full truth. The full truth was they were actually going to die. And the death that Christ meant was eternal death. Was eternal death. And he didn't tell them because he had died eternally already. He had lost that connection. He had the connection with God. He has lost his, his spirituality with God. So he wanted them to follow the same. So he told them half truth is equal to a lie. Any incomplete truth is equal to a lie. And that's how the devil deceives people. He tells something that looks like the truth, but it is not. He just bends it a little. He bends it a little, so then he ends up making it more complicated. He complicates the gospel. He makes it more complicated. Praise the Lord. And it is through these half-truths and complications that will give him better traditions. Traditions that is keeping people out of Christ, out of the gospel, out of the house of God. Lots and lots of traditions based on meaningless things. The devil is now using those half-truths to destroy the body of Christ. And these are his tricks. And the whole idea of these half-truths is so you can lose the consciousness that you have about your righteousness. So you can lose that righteous consciousness. So you will not be conscious anymore of the fact that you are the righteousness of God in Christ. And the moment you begin to lose that consciousness, then you begin to lose your salvation. The moment you begin to lose that consciousness that you have been saved by the blood of the Lamb, and by the word of your testimony, the moment you begin to lose that consciousness that you are the redeemed of the Lord, the moment you begin to lose that consciousness that there is nothing that can separate you from the love of God, the moment you begin to lose that consciousness, then you begin to lose your right standing with God, you begin to lose your relationship with God, and then you can't relate with God properly no more, because now you've lost that boldness. You begin to lose it. And then he makes you to feel, no, you see, God is too righteous and too holy. He can't accept you. No, you're too filthy. You're too wrong. What you've done, no, God will not forgive you. Ah, praise God. He will not forgive. He has already forgiven you. It is you that have not accepted the forgiveness. Who told you? He tells you, you see, what you just done is the sin against the Holy Ghost. You see, the sin against the Holy Ghost, which the devil wants you to commit, is the sin of denying the finished work of Christ. The sin of rejecting that work and denying it, denying that Jesus Christ is the Lord. When you begin to deny it, then you are walking your way towards that state, that apostate state, because now you are tested of the power of God. You've seen of his might. You've believed in Jesus, and then suddenly one day you wake up and you say, Jesus Christ is not God. Maybe he's just a prophet. Maybe just like every other person. No, he's not. You've lost it. You've lost it. And that's what the devil wants. He wants you to get to that point where you don't care anymore. You don't care about the word of God anymore. You feel the word of God is not working because you are filled in your path. He leads you astray and then keeps leading you until he stains your heart completely, and then you stop believing in what you have once believed. That's how he cries, why he comes like a prophet, but he's not. He's a false prophet. He comes as if he is, but he's not. He's not a light. He just tries to transform himself, you know, into some form of light, some form of godliness, you know. Let me tell you the truth. This is from me to you. One of the easiest way the devil have used to penetrate the church through false prophets mostly is through giving. Alms giving. You know, see, they use alms. They call the poor, and then they share rice. They share money. They give scholarships. These are good things you do in the kingdom of God when you do them with a pure conscience, and when you do them as a believer, and they're not just doing them, but you do them and you still teach people the word of God and lead them to Christ, give them the wisdom that God wants from them. And then when you do these things from biblical perspective, Bible says, let your left hand not see what your right hand. No, this is my left hand. Yes, this is your musical right hand. Let your left hand not see what your right hand has done. So you are doing it with your right hand, you hide your left hand so he doesn't see it. That means you don't come, you're giving alms, and then you're taking a selfie. No, that's unbiblical, trying to take it through the world. Praise God. There are instances you can do that if maybe probably you have invested people that gave and you're trying to maybe raise more funds or trying to get them to know that what they've given is being used for this. Then the reason for you to do that is different. But when you're doing it, you have people to praise you and say, ah, he's a good man. He's giving to the poor. You see, he's in the work of, he's just like Christ. Then the devil, that is you being used as a deceiver. And beyond just giving alms, you're giving alms, and then you, as a preacher, you are practicing the word and you're preaching the word. What the word says, praise God. Praise God. You're not focused on that. You're doing that, but you're practicing the word. As an individual that is doing it, you're doing it and you're practicing what the word of God says. Trying to change lives with the Bible. But that's what will change these lives. Praise God. But the devil uses these channels that can get human sympathy to draw men out of the body of Christ, to drag them into numerous traditions and customs and what have you. Now, how to overcome the devil? James chapter 4. How do you overcome the devil? How do you overcome him? James chapter 4, verse 7 makes it very, well, the Bible says something very straight to the point. It says, submit yourself therefore to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. It's straightforward. Put yourself under God's authority. Submit yourself to God. Put yourself under God's authority. If you read verse 6 earlier, it says, but he giveth more grace, wherefore he said, God resisted the proud, but give a grace to the humble. That means when you put yourself under God's authority, you learn humility. You humble yourself before the Almighty. You learn humility. You are nothing. You are nothing but a person in the hands of the Creator. You are just an object God is using to do your work. You know, Jesus talked about the Father. You are the servant who you've gone to do your work, and you come back and you say, Master, I have done the work which I am supposed to do. I have gone to do my work as a humble servant. I don't really deserve any reward. I've done my work. Praise God. You're not coming back to God. This is the reward for the work you've done, but you're coming back. You've done the work that you know you are just an unprofitable servant. You've just done the work. Praise God. So you need to humble yourself before God. You are nothing but a person. And so bring yourself down. Leave your titles. Leave who you are. Bring yourself down to serve God where he has placed you. And then James chapter 1, verse 22 talked about be doers of the word and not hearers only, deceive yourself. So practice the word you hear. Put it to work. This is how you will see the devil. You put yourself under God's authority. You learn humility. You practice the word of God you hear. Practice the word. And then lastly, then you can be able to resist it. When you put yourself under God's authority, you humble yourself before God, you practice the word of God, then the next, you resist him. How do you resist the devil? With your command, your actions, your inactions, your dedication, your giving. That's how you resist the devil. You see, he comes, you rebuke the devil, and he will flee from you. You rebuke him. The Bible says, rebuke the devil. You rebuke him. Get deep behind me, Satan, he will flee. He will flee because your word comes with authority. When the devil tries to stop you from going boldly for the throne of grace, you take action. You go boldly before God and then you obtain mercy. You take action, you go out and you do the work of God. You do what is right. Then some actions that you're not supposed to take, he tries to get to take a bribe. No, you stop it. When he tries to get you to confrontation, you stop it. He tries to get you to do something wrong, you stop it. Rather, you dedicate yourself to the work of the Almighty. And you give. You give to God. You give to the church. You give your time, you give your money, you give to people, you give alms. Giving is vital in the body of Christ. I'm not going to underemphasize that. As much as I said, you have to give the pure conscience. Giving is vital in the body of Christ. Not just giving to the church, giving to the people that need it. Giving alms, praise God. Giving to the less privileged is important. You are privileged because God wants to give to those who are less privileged. Amen. And amen. I believe you've been blessed by the word of God today. May the hand of the Lord be upon you this season. May he increase you. May he multiply you on all sides. Whatever you do this week will prosper. You will increase. You will be on top and never be night. In Jesus' name. Amen. On Wednesday, we're going to talk about the righteous mindset. Now, see you on Wednesday by 2 afternoon. Don't miss the service for anything. The righteous mindset on Wednesday. The Lord bless you. Amen.